watching online today. If you could like or comment on the live stream, that way we know that you are here. So some announcements. Saturday, January 22nd is Women on Mission Gathering at 9:30 at Franklin Baptist Association Building. Sunday, January 23rd is Baptist Men's Day. Men of the church are encouraged to sing in a Sunday morning choir with familiar songs. If you are interested in this, you can connect with Tommy and he will get you more information. Wednesday, January 26th is our quarterly business meeting at 6:30 p.m. And then something new that we're doing for Operation Christmas Child is out in the hall, we have a sheet and it has different items we're collecting each month. Rather than, if you want to do it this way, you can, rather than at the end of the year trying to collect everything all at once, we'll have just different things each month you can donate, so it takes a little pressure off you. And then,
still our hearts before the Lord and prepare for worship. Let's pray together. Father, as we draw near to you in prayer, we're so thankful for your many blessings, most of all, our freedom and our salvation in Jesus Christ. Lord, as we look to Sanctity of Life Sunday, Father, we lift up a prayer for women, for men that are in emergency pregnancy situations. Father, we pray that we as the church, the body of Christ, would partner with places like Lifeline, Pregnancy Center, to come alongside those situations, to love our neighbor in that way, and to be the body of Christ unto those who need help and encouragement in the truth of the gospel. Lord, as we think about our worship today, we pray that you would give us ears to hear and eyes to see the truth of your word and your gospel. Help us to lean in and to hear amid all of the distractions and the things the enemy would love us to trip up on. We pray, Lord, today we would be intent upon your word and your message, and Lord, you would help us to focus today on what you would have for us, that we would be more conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's hear our prelude together. I invite you to stand with us as we sing the song Everlasting God. Let's sing together. we serve today. That he's the defender of the weak, the ones that are needy, the ones that are overlooked by the world. God sees, and he works through us to love and to care for. Would you sing this familiar classic, "To God Be the Glory"?
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. is above the heavens. Nothing is impossible for him. No one can stay his hand. And we are his ambassadors. We are the ones that share this ministry of reconciliation between God and man. And as we draw near to our time of offering and our other worship elements, I ask Sarah to come and pray for us. As our ushers come, we'll receive that. If you're visiting with us, we're just thankful for you to be here with us. Don't feel any pressure today to give. If you're watching online, which is what many of us are doing today, I suspect, we give through Tithely as well. That's how Sarah and I give as well. But don't feel any pressure if you're watching for the first time. We're thankful for you to be our guest. So Sarah, would you pray for us?
Father God, we just thank you so much for the gifts and the givers, Father. Father, we ask that you use this money to further your kingdom, Father, to teach us to love those around us, Father, like we love them, like a forgiving love that can never be stopped, that no matter what happens, Father, that you are there and you love us and teach us to love like that, Father. Father, I ask that you be with Brother Tommy as he teaches from your word, Father, and I ask that you bless and that you teach us and that we grow, and Father, I just pray that you teach us to love. In your name I pray.
Sanctity of Life Sunday, and we always have this partnership with Lifeline Pregnancy Center. We collect the baby bottles from Mother's Day to Father's Day, and so we have a guest speaker from Lifeline Pregnancy Center named Margaret Disbrough, but we're going to start with a video. Let's watch this.
Once upon a time, I was a princess, complete with my royal horse and tiara. And of course, I dreamed of a daring young Prince Charming. My dream of the life we would have together was so close, so real, so happily ever after. In high school, I thought I'd finally found him, and that my happily ever after would come true. He promised we'd get married, and we live in a big house. He seemed so confident, so sure. But when I got pregnant, he was gone, and all my dreams were shattered. The only thing he left besides my broken heart was an envelope with $300 cash and the address of an abortion clinic. Crushed and alone, I decided to get it over with, put that chapter behind me, and go on to college. Deep down inside, it wasn't over. At college, I threw myself into my studies to ease the pain and feelings of worthlessness. In my junior year, Tony appeared on his white horse. This time, he really loved me. He had a plan to build our life together. I dared to dream again. But the plot twisted with another positive pregnancy test. He thought we were too young. What about our plans? What about our parents? School, money. I saw the script of my life shredding again before my eyes. Instead of making an appointment at the abortion clinic, though, he took us first to the pregnancy center. There, they listened to our uncertainties and fears, then introduced us to our daughter. With tears streaming down our cheeks, we both fell in love again, this time with our unborn baby. This litter helped us plan and get ready for her and our future, and most importantly, they introduced me to the one who has always loved me, enough to die for me and give me a new, clean, forever life. My story is a bit different than my childhood princess dream, but thanks to the pregnancy center, we did get a happily ever after. The credits at the end of my story include a thanks to you, all of you who have given and volunteered at the center. But this is not really the end. There are so many others like us. Will you help write the next chapter with them?
Good morning. Lifeline Pregnancy Care Center in Cuba. I've been there for just started my fifth year. I'm the client services director, so I work directly with the clients. I'm the one that sees those that come in that's confused and don't know what to do. And so I work with them. When I first started this, I thought, Lord, I'm not a public speaker, so I just all want you to know that I'm not a public speaker. So, but when I get up here and it's my passion, I don't have a problem letting the Lord use me, and I sometimes don't shut up. So if you need to flag me, go ahead. And so anyways, we at Lifeline, we not only now work with pregnant women, but we have also opened up two more programs at our center that I'm not sure you guys are aware of. One is we now work with parents who have lost their children to DFS and who are trying to get custody back. A lot of these parents don't know how to parent, and this seemed like a good outreach for us into the community, because why not show them the love of God too? And the other one we have is really taking off, and it's parenting classes for dads. I've got two dads right now in this class, enrolled in the class. One has been with us. When he first started, he wanted to come 12 weeks. That was his goal, 12 weeks. I'm going to be here 12 weeks. So when 12 weeks got here, I said, 12 weeks, I really like coming. So this past week I counted, he had 35 weeks in the parenting classes. And I said to him, you've been here 35 weeks. Well, does that mean I got to stop? I said, oh, no, we can keep going. I keep you busy until they're five. I got enough lessons to go 5 years. Okay, let's keep going. So he has been on our program, and for 35, it'll be 36 weeks this week when he comes back on Tuesday. So he is a prime example of there are fathers out there that want their children, and they want to learn and do right by their children, and he comes by himself. He's not married. He's got custody of his two children, and he wants to make sure he parents them correctly. And the biggest blessing over this is that we've been talking with him as he comes in, because he's not a church guy. But this last week, we asked him, said, do you want that Bible yet? Because we have Bibles that we give out. He said, you know, I think I want that Bible this week. So it's those little blessings that keep us going and tell us that that's the Lord saying, you're doing what you need to do. This is good. So I was just going to share a couple of stories about our clients, because that's what I do at the center. And I want to thank you all for your support. We're very thankful for your baby bottle support, the support you give to us. I'm thankful for the warm greeting today. Everybody's been so kind to me, and I appreciate that. Because like I said, I don't always get up and do well with these things. But anyways, my first client I want to tell you about, we saved a baby. I like to call this story, save a baby on the first one, we saved a family on the second. So the first one, she come in and she'd had her tubes tied, and she'd already had three little ones, and she said, my pregnancy test says I'm pregnant, and there's just absolutely no way I've had my tubes tied, no way. And so she was very distraught, upset, I already have three, I don't need another one. And I'm like, calm down. So we sat and we chatted about it for a while, and she left with the commitment to go ahead and carry this fourth child. And the first three was girls, and the next one was a girl also. And she now has four children that she is raising. And so in that aspect, she came in, she did our parenting classes. We helped her with rent and electric and baby supplies. So we were able to help her in that area. And then my next one that came in, they had lost their children to DFS. And while they were coming to us for parenting classes, she also found out she was pregnant. So we were able to step in and help with that also. And we were able to help with, once again, rent, electric, and supplies, and parenting classes. Both parents came to the parenting classes faithfully. They were able to get their children back from DFS. They're back in the home. Matter of fact, him and her now have gotten married. They're both in college. They both hold down good jobs. They've welcomed their baby boy. And when they first started coming to us, I was told, we don't do the Jesus thing. Okay. We don't force it on anybody, but we live the life of Christ so they can see it through us. And so the last time she contacted me, she said, you know, I told you we didn't do that Jesus thing. And I said, yeah. She said, well, now we do that Jesus thing. So now they're in church every Sunday morning. They don't miss. They're very faithful to their church. Their church is a huge support for them. They've moved down the area. And I can't help but be like a proud mama, because it's like, this is stuff that you don't always get to see the happy endings to. Sometimes we have girls that come in and they leave and we don't know where they went. We don't ever hear from them again. But the Lord gives us those success stories, and it's enough to keep us going, always keep us going. So we do thank you guys for all your support. It is working. It is helping. It helps us to reach out into the community. We did pay our building off in November of last year, and we paid it off about 4 years early. We've really been praying because we have so many now that we need more classrooms. So before we could build more classrooms, we needed to pay off our loan. We got it paid off, and before the end of the year, we got several donations in, one-time donations. You pray, the Lord answers, and we now have a nice down payment to be able to expand and maybe start some of those classrooms by summertime. So we're really excited to see how the Lord's using us and how we're growing, and we're able to reach out in the community. And one of the mamas' child got hurt at the park, and she come running in, and she said, this is the only place I could think to come to. And I said, yes, we're doing what we're supposed to be doing. So thank you all for your support. We greatly appreciate it. If you guys have any questions afterwards, you can feel free to hunt me down or wave me down or whatever. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
You want that back?
Sure.
Well, thank you, Margaret. Appreciate you so much. Can't tell you how important it is to me that we're partnered with folks like that that are doing that kind of work. But I got to make a rough transition now into a sermon, if that's okay. I've been accused, even lately, of hearing what I want to hear. Has anybody ever been accused of that? Of hearing only what you want to hear? As a member of the male species, one of my many born defects is selective hearing. And I'm reminded of the Simon, because I'm an old soul, I'm reminded of the Simon Garfunkel lyric, all lies in jest, still a man hears what he wants to hear and disregards the rest. That's what I feel like my life story is. On the day that I sat down to study for this sermon, I had just received troubling news. It was after the holidays, and I went to the scale to weigh myself. And when I came home later on, I could swear I heard Benny say to me, hey, when you get home today, you want me to bake you a cherry pie? No, I don't want to. And his face was like a face of shock and terror. And he said, Dad, I said, can we watch a Harry Potter movie when you get home? Sometimes a man hears what he wants to hear and disregards the rest. We're bad at hearing, and because we're bad at hearing, we're bad at acting sometimes too. I want you to hold your hand like this. Everybody, hold your hand, come on. Hold your hand like this. Now put it on your chin. I want you to take your hand like this. I'm gonna give you another chance. I want you to put it on your chin. Alright, did you do it? Did you do it? Did it take you a couple times? Alright. We are bad at hearing. Or another application is people follow what they see more than what they hear. And so we should be careful how we are acting, because that's mostly what people respond to. Some people call it Freudian, to hear what you want. Some people call it good old-fashioned male selective hearing, but the Bible addresses it in a different way. I want to take an honest look at our hearing problem this morning. Not with our physical ears, but with our spiritual ears, so to speak. And I want to tell you that I am hard of hearing most of the time. I'm hard of hearing spiritually. And God has to get my attention through some pretty extreme means. Maybe you feel like you're that way as well. I don't want to be that way. I need the Holy Spirit's help to do as Jesus said, to have ears to hear and eyes to see. And I hope that that's your prayer this morning as well. So we've been in a series through the book of James. And so if you would turn with me to James chapter 1, verse 19. We're in our second sermon through that. We've been in a series, we've called it Faith in Motion, because James' job is to get the message across and to get your faith to match your lifestyle. And that's why the book of James is a beloved favorite to many, because James gets to the point and gets in your face and tells you what to do. If you want a book of the Bible that tells you how to live your life, the book of James has a healthy helping of that. And so now in the theme that we see over and over again, James wants to make sure that we're truly living out the gospel that we profess. So if you found James chapter 1, verse 19, I invite you to stand with us again as we read God's word together. He says, "My dear brothers and sisters, understand this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger." That right there is enough for today, right? That's hard. "For human anger does not accomplish God's righteousness. Therefore, ridding yourself of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, humbly receive the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. Because if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like someone who is looking at his own face in a mirror. For he looks at himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of person he was. But the one who looks intently into the perfect law of freedom and perseveres in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer who works, this person will be blessed in what he does. If anyone thinks he is religious without controlling his tongue, his religion is useless and he deceives himself. Pure and undefiled religion before God the Father is this, to look after orphans and widows." And if I could just editorialize a little bit. And unwed mothers in crisis pregnancy situations. Pure and undefiled religion is this, to look after them in their distress and to keep oneself unstained from the world. Let's pray together. Father, we need your help. We need your Holy Spirit's guidance today as we lean in to all that you have for us today. We pray that you would help us to focus. Open our ears together. Open our eyes to see and help us to live out the word that is implanted in our souls. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and take a seat. I've titled this message "On Hearing, Adhering, and Cohering to the Word." And that's really, you've just heard the whole sermon. You can go now if you'd like. But the traffic probably won't be heavy out there. But we need to hear the Word together today. We need to adhere to it. In other words, obey to it. And we need to cohere, stick to it in such a way that it defines our religion, our lifestyle. And so as we receive the gospel and the Holy Spirit's work, we'll see, this is our outline, three ways the Spirit empowers us to respond to the Word. This is what we need today. Look at verse 19 with me to begin. "My dear brothers and sisters, understand this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger." That's a wise word. We put a lot of respect on those who speak. But James puts a lot of respect on those who listen first. Have you noticed, you probably have, that we've been given one mouth and two ears. And so it would stand to reason that we should listen twice as much as we speak. But that's not the law of the land. That's not the code of our world. James is the New Testament version of the book of Proverbs, in a sense. And so it shouldn't surprise us that there are many Proverbs that back up this principle. It says, "When words are many, transgression is not lacking. But whoever restrains his lips is prudent." Proverbs 10:19. Whoever restrains their lips, who stops themselves from talking. That's a good word. It says, "Even a fool who keeps silent is considered wise. When he closes his lips, he is deemed intelligent." Proverbs 17:28. There's great wisdom in listening first and speaking later. Many in our world don't listen at all. In fact, they are all reaction, 100% reaction, within a preset range of emotions, like Batman's utility belt, ready to fire out, right? Here's my outrage, here's my sadness, here's my joy. We just listen, we talk and react first. We listen far later. We could go down the list of things that provoke a wide variety of emotions today. Just to name a few, we could talk about immigration. Probably people have feelings about that. We could talk about guns. People have feelings about that. We could talk about COVID. People have feelings about that. We could talk about the school system. People have feelings about that. But all, if I may say, with very little listening. Very little listening. If your first thought is to react before you've heard, what benefit is that? We would do better to install the filter, to open up our ears, to get all the facts straight before that we talk. And that's the folly of our news media, isn't it? That we have to get out there with our hot take and be the first on the case before the facts have settled. But this is doubly true with the scriptures. The most important filter to any of these is the subjects in the word, that when it's talked about in the Word of God. To listen to what the Word of God says about any of these things that we have mentioned and to hear what it says. And so number one, by the Holy Spirit's guidance, we need to have the power to receive the Word. We need to ask God today, give me the power to receive, to hear what the Word says. We have to be slow to speak, quick to listen. I had a professor at Missouri Baptist University who was a slow talker. And because he was a slow talker, many of the students, they just hated his class. Because if you would ask him a question, he would just sit there and he would think about it. He would sit there for maybe, it seemed like, minutes and think about that. And then he would slowly, in a kind of drawn-out manner, go through his answer. And if you remember sitting in any kind of classroom, high school classroom, college classroom, minutes feel like hours. And so they didn't appreciate this man. But I did. I learned to appreciate it because this was a guy who didn't let his words fly. He didn't come off and shoot from the hip. He was disciplined to think, to be exact, because he knew why. He knew people counted on him to be accurate. The world could take note. I can appreciate that. Someone who listens and thinks and is not quick to speak. We're prone to react first and think later. He says everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. Why? For human anger does not accomplish God's righteousness. You know, outrage is sort of the theme of our day, isn't it? We're always given a list of things for which we should be angry about and upset with. And not all anger is bad, but what's under fire here is quick tempers, which always result in disastrous results. Notice that anger does lead to results. But look at what the text says. It doesn't get God's results. And do you notice that? Anger will get you results. It may get you what you want, but it doesn't get what God wants. It says it does not accomplish God's righteousness. The word righteousness means when things are in line with God's will. And so by busting a gasket, you might have gotten your way, but you have very well not gotten God's way. And God's means of doing things. And all of us will stand before God and answer for every loose word that escaped our lips. I find that very convicting today. That we can't take back the word once it's spoken. And so we should do better to listen carefully and be slow to speak. Look at verse 21. Therefore, because of this, ridding yourselves of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, humbly receive the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. That word, that phrase, ridding off in the Greek, it's literally the phrase used to take off clothes. The image of taking off dirty clothes so that we can put on clean, fresh clothes. James is saying, get rid of that anger and that dirtiness so that you can receive the word. There's great wisdom in this, to check our sin at the door and so that we can hear the word. And you know, when Barb plays the prelude music, there's great wisdom in us saying together, let's spend some time with God. You know, you carry in here, me too, we carry in here all of this baggage and all of these ideas from this past week. And the inner monologue that just won't shut up is just constantly flurrying within our head. And maybe there's a moment, because there's really no moment outside of here, where we can say, just take a few minutes and breathe. And let's get ready to receive. Let's get ready to receive. That's a good idea. We should take off the burden of anger and moral filth and all the baggage that we have so that we can receive the word and hear first and react later. Look at verse 22. We got more. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. You know, it is good to hear, But it's not good just to hear, is what he's saying. It is good to hear, but you don't stop there. You don't just hear. If you aren't obeying the word, you aren't truly even hearing it. If you have not acted out what the word says, you have not heard it right. You might say today as you're in your pew, I am listening as hard as I can. As hard as I can, I am listening right now to you. And at home, I've watched sermons and services at home, and there are many distractions as cinnamon rolls are in the oven and things are beeping and things are going and phones are buzzing. I watched how many of you were on there and some of you are getting on and all of these things. It is difficult to listen. But until you are obeying, it says you're deceiving yourselves, even when you're listening. Until you have acted it out, until it's reached from your ears to your hands and feet, he says you're deceiving yourselves. And not only just to obey it once, James says. James calls them doers. You know what that means? That means continuously obeying the word in your life. Not one of us is perfect. Not one of us has arrived. And yet he calls us to be continuous doers of the word, obedient to what the word says. It implies continuously living out the word in your life. So number two, by the Holy Spirit's guidance, we must gain the power to obey the word. To obey the word. To give us ears to hear, yes, but to give us hands which will act out in obedience to what he says. Look at verse 23. Because if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like someone looking at his own face in a mirror. For he looks at himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of person he is. This is an idea of a foolish person. You know, mirrors in the ancient world were not made out of glass. They were made out of polished metal, actually. And they would get the job done, but they were imperfect. You can only see, I mean, you try that. Polish some metal and see if you can see yourself like you would see in a glass. It's not the same. But those people, it's kind of fascinating. Those people back then wanted to look right just as we want to look right now. But it was imperfect. It was looking through a mirror dimly. That's why Paul says that. Now we look at a mirror dimly. That's that polished glass that would only show so much of it. It wasn't in high definition. But this right here is the mirror of our soul. What a mirror in the ancient world would do imperfectly, this does for us in our soul. When we read it, it reads us. It understands us better than we do, and it exposes all of our failings and our shortcomings. It exposes who we are before God so that we might do something about it. You know, as I was thinking about this, believe it or not, all of this doesn't come together naturally. You maybe didn't know that, but this takes time, right? Even though I try to be well-rested on Saturday nights and Sunday mornings, when I get up and I crawl into the bathroom and I look at myself in the mirror, I look like some sort of movie monster. You know what I'm saying? And my beard is all pointing in different directions. My neck is hairy. My hair is a mess. And what if I looked at the mirror and saw all of that? I thought about taking a picture and showing you. Far too embarrassed to do that. Saw all of that and then just came to church anyway. Some of y'all said, that's what you did. That's what you did today. But believe it or not, I look in the mirror and this is the best you can get. You know, this is after some work, right? And so you have to do something around it. You guys look great, by the way. You guys look awesome. So James, his big brother, who's kind of important, if you remember, he backs him up on this. In the Gospel of Luke, there's an interesting passage where a woman yells at Jesus. She yells out from the crowd to Jesus and says, blessed is the womb that bore you and the breast by which you were nourished. Kind of an interesting thought. That's why we dismiss the kids, okay? But Jesus shouts back and says, no. Blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Luke 11:28. He goes, that's great. Mary is great. All this is great. But you know who really is blessed? The one who hears the word, but doesn't only do that, but keeps it in their life. There are folks who come to church who look into the mirror of the word, and in their mind they're really listening, but when they walk away from the mirror, their hair is all messed up, they have bags under their eyes, they have ear hair, you know, whatever the case is. Common sense dictates that when we see something wrong, we do something about it, but You know what that requires? Here's the hang-up. It requires an intentional decision to allow the Word to be the mirror of our soul. And that means the Bible, God's Word, gets to say something about us. Now, that's not all negative, is it? Because what else does the Bible say about me? What else does God, through His Word, say about me? He calls me a son or a daughter of God. He calls me His own. He calls me a saint. He calls me His disciple, His follower, His student. And He sends me out. And so it isn't a negative thing, but it is a humbling, uncomfortable process. But it's the way in which we glorify God by becoming what He would have for us in the mirror. He didn't save you just to stay where you are. He loves you too much to leave you where you are, but to make you more and more and more like His Son, Jesus. God doesn't point out your sin for your shame, but for His glory through you. That's why He does it. I have a mentor, a guy I love in my life. He says, God loves to point out sin because He loves to forgive sin. He loves to forgive sin, and He loves you. James is going to give examples of what it means to be a doer of the Word. Look at verse 26. He said, if anyone thinks he is religious without controlling his tongue, his religion is useless and he deceives himself. That word religious or religion, it's a broad term. Just as broad as it is today, the reason why it's not used often in the Bible is the same reason we don't really use it today. It's because it's a broad term. It refers to any sort of religious devotion, maybe to God or maybe to any other number of gods. And so it's a very broad term, and it talks about the outward and not the inward. You can be religious, and that says nothing about what's in your heart, right? It's talking about the outward, but not the inward. And so you could very well be religious and be devoted to rituals that are meaningless to you inside of your heart. James is about to test that religion, to say, this is how we know if your religion is true. This is how you know that your devotion and your piety is true. We're going to put that to the test. And so there must be something different about us than just religious ritual that we do. The coming to church on Sunday morning and the prayers before dinner. There must be something drastically different from us from the rest of the world. And so number three, we need the Holy Spirit's work to help us have the power to live different. Verse 26 is about controlling your tongue. If you read, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on that, because if you read through the book of James, I'm going to have a whole sermon on controlling your tongue. That would be a fun Sunday. I'm not going to tell you which Sunday, you won't come. And so, me neither. But the fact is, if you cannot control yourself, your expression of faith, it comes up hollow with your rituals and with your services. I find that convicting. But he piles onto it in verse 27. All of this is going to come to a point, right? Verse 27, he says, pure and undefiled religion before God the Father is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep yourself unstained from the world. I'm going to take a moment and I want to talk about the word religion or religious. Because the word religious is kind of a bad word in our culture. Nobody wants to be religious, right? In the Greek, it means pious or devout. And those are kind of bad adjectives in our society too these days. Someone who is described as pious, well, look at him, he's so pious. That doesn't mean devoted anymore. That means arrogant, right? Or legalistic or uppity or these things. And there was kind of this movement of hip youth pastors and senior pastors who would say, oh no, I'm not religious. I'm a Christ follower. And I remember as a young man thinking, oh yeah, that's cool. Because the merit to that was to distance ourselves from this kind of cold legalism. You know, no, I'm not religious like that. I'm just a follower of Jesus. And surely there are folks that are religious but not Christians. And not to be mean today, but there are people that populate pews every Sunday morning that are awfully religious and on every measurable external bracket say, I am a Christian, I'm a religious person, but in their heart they are far from God. Jesus said that to the religious people in his day. He said, outwardly, you conform to all these rules and all these laws and all these bylaws, but inside of your heart you're far from God. Far be it from us to be religious on the outside, but not have a heart that is warm to the things of God, that loves Jesus and follows him in his heart. But behind that statement, if I could say the flip side to that, I'm not religious, I'm just, you know, hanging out. There was a desire to be cool, right? There was a desire to be hip. No, no, this is not your grandma's church because we're not religious like they were. Well, I want to ask a question. Did it work? This kind of movement, did it work? Did that sentiment reach America? No, it didn't. Instead, we have a whole generation now where the majority of them would say, yeah, I believe in God and I think Jesus is cool, but I'm not religious. And then they'll proceed to never darken the door of a church. It didn't work. It didn't work. You know where we went wrong? Now stay with me here. You know where we went wrong? We tried to be cool. We tried to be cool. And we elevated cool as like the maximum ethic of church and of being a pastor and of being Christians. We tried to be cool. Why did we think that the world that crucified Jesus would ever think that we would be cool? When did we get that idea? We need to be above cool. You know, that's what I'm calling. We need to be something above that, something more eternal than what's called cool. We don't need to be whatever cool is. We need to be whatever Jesus is. That's what we need. Are y'all with me here today? And I think what our culture needs from us is not cool, but real and honest and humble and loving and whatever Jesus is and has for us. And this is good news for me because I have given up on cool. I like the rock band Weezer and Batman comics, okay? I am not cool. I am not cool. And I'm not ever going to be cool. But what I hope I am is honest, is real, is true, is loving from my heart and not from a pious, fake, religious thing. I hope that I'm real. And so I say don't be afraid to be devout. Maybe even pious. And don't be afraid to take your faith seriously. And if people call you religious for that, who cares? Just tell them they're cool. We don't need to be cool. We need to be like Jesus. And so we're to look after the most vulnerable. Orphans and widows were the most needy of their time, the most overlooked, the most oppressed. And we serve a God who said, you shall not mistreat any widow or fatherless child, Exodus 22:22. He's the God who said of himself that he executes justice for the fatherless and the widow. He loves the sojourner, giving them food and clothing. Love the sojourner, therefore, for you were once sojourners, he told the Israelites in Deuteronomy 10:18-19. And so those folks who cannot reciprocate love and care, they can never pay you back. Those were the litmus test. How you treated them was truly the test of if you're going to live out the sacrificial love of Jesus. This is not a I'll scratch your back, you scratch mine sort of mentality. Because what Jesus did for us, we can never pay back. And so as his followers, we're to love and to help and to reach to folks that can never, ever return the favor. That's why I'm pro-life. That's why I'm pro-life. Because I believe in standing with the most overlooked, alongside of women with crisis pregnancies in their time of anxiety and in fear. And so instead of being cool, love the people in the world that the world doesn't think is cool. That's what we should be busying ourselves about and keeping ourselves unstained from the world. That doesn't mean, it's too cheap to say that that means what movies you listen to and what music you listen to. But to keep yourself distant from the world system. As one writer said, the system of disorder, contrary to the heavenly order. That's what it means to keep yourself unstained from how the world thinks and what the world does. The cliche rings true, to be in the world, but not of the world. The world system lives in rebellion against our God, and we're not to call that kingdom home, but Christ's kingdom. We live in his kingdom by the gospel. And so, that's never going to be. That's never going to be acceptable. That's going to be a little bit religious. But I'm content to serve my King and to not be judged by some arbitrary standard down here. And I think what we need to do as a church is shed the desire of acceptance and seek after the acceptance of King Jesus. I think, are y'all asleep? No, do you want me to be cool? Would you rather do that? No, I think we should do what Jesus would have us do. So are you listening today? Don't just hear what you want to hear and disregard the rest. Because if we're Christians, we can respond to the word rightly. By the Holy Spirit in us, we can hear the word. We can adhere to the word. We can obey it. And it can cohere to us so that we look more like Jesus than we do the world. He said, "He who has ears, let him hear." It was Jesus who says, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him." John 6:44. So I ask you, is that Holy Spirit working in your life today? Are you hearing, maybe for the first time, listener online, or folks that are here, are you listening for the first time that life is more than just this right here? And the acceptance and the fear of man that so many people are worried about, the I scratch your back and you scratch my back mentality. But his word calls us to be a peculiar people, to be a people called by his own name. And when we're never really going to blend in. If we do that, if we follow Jesus, we're never really going to blend in. But one day, the books will be open. And if Jesus is your Lord, you won't be saved that day because of your works, because of your hearing or your doing, but because of the blood of Jesus. In Christ, even when the mirror of the word exposes our sin to us and makes us level with who we are, there is forgiveness and grace at the cross of Jesus. The word will expose your sin, not so that you can be in shame because of it, and not even so that you can just do better. But the heart of the mirror of the word is to show you your sin so that you fall to your knees in repentance before King Jesus. That you put your faith in him. So that is my question. Not to look in this and do better, but to look in this and submit to Jesus and say, "God, I need your mercy and your grace. I need you to save me. I need your spirit in my life." So folks in the pews, folks on the other side of this device, is that true of you today? Have you truly made that commitment? Have you listened and heard? And are you responding in faith to the Lord Jesus today? Do you know that you know that you know that if you die today, your sins are forgiven, that you have a home in heaven, that you're covered by the blood of Jesus, his righteousness, and that that's your defense? And then, believer, are you sure? Are you sure that you are walking in truth today? That you have humbled your heart to submit to this mirror to say, "Teach me how to walk like Jesus and not like the world." And in doing so, to look after those who are oppressed and overlooked, who are so distraught and in anxiety and fear, and the world does not care. Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to ask those questions before the Lord today? I'd invite you to stand with us as we respond to that. Let me pray. Father, we thank you so much again for your word. We thank you that it is a mirror to our soul. We thank you that it's sharper than a double-edged sword, that it pierces bone and marrow, soul and spirit. And as we read it, it reads us, it exposes things in our life. Father, there are some listening today, maybe present today, Lord, that the response that they must take is, "Lord, save me from my sin." Because in the gospel, there's no amount of doing that is going to make up for our sin. We must come to Jesus, place our faith in him, repent of our sins, and be made new. But Father, there are some in here that have walked with Jesus for many years, but we have forgotten about the mirror. We've forgotten to hear because we have believed in our souls we're doing fine. We have forgot to be continuous doers, obeyers of the word. We've lost that urgency in our life to walk in truth. And Father, maybe even our spirit has become religious, so that it's more about an outward activity rather than our relationship and love for you, O Lord. If that's true of any of us, I pray that today, right now, would be the time of response, that we would repent of our sins, turning from those things and turn to your design again. Oh Lord, would you accomplish that in our lives, that you would be glorified? I pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Let's respond. Let's sing together. Watching online, or if you're here and God is working on your heart and you're wondering what the next step is, one thing you could do is you could text DECISION to 636-742-1011. That would love for that to be a beginning point for us to have a discussion. That goes straight to me, and we can begin to have a discussion about what God's next step is for you. Maybe you need to follow the Lord in baptism. Maybe you're interested in greater service to the Lord. Maybe the Lord has brought a conviction upon your life to hear the word and obey it, and to keep yourself unstained from all the world. I know the Lord has worked in my heart today. I hope that that's true of you as well. I'm going to pray, and then Sarah is going to sing us out. Did we forget anything? Christina, thank you for the announcements. It was great. You did good. Covered all the bases. Thank you, Margaret, and she's going to be out front, I'm sure, and her husband Mark, and they can answer questions about you. It's kind of different because we see them, we say, hey, glad you're doing what you're doing. And then we have the baby bottles, you know, Mother's Day to Father's Day. But believe it or not, they work all year round. And so they're doing what they're doing all year round. So we want to keep them in our prayers, keep them in our thoughts, and other such pregnancy care centers. And listen, in Missouri, they're winning. They're winning. God is doing an incredible thing in Missouri. And we need to pray for them. And the church needs to rally around these sort of things. And to help those that are in need. So much need for the truth. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this sanctity of life Sunday. Help us to hear. Help us to obey. Help us, Lord, to think of those who are most in need and are most overlooked. And help us, our religion, to be defined by how we love them more than it is defined by our ritual, by our laws and our duties and the things that we fill our life with. Father, help us to be like Jesus to those that are around us. Lord, forgive us whenever we long to be accepted more than we long to be obedient. Lord, help us when we want our message to be palatable more than we want it to be true. And as we're sent out into our mission field, help us to proclaim the gospel to others. And help us, Lord, to live like Jesus in front of them. For us in Jesus.